Well, Australia's overseas passenger arrivals have rebounded to be now 80% of pre-COVID levels, the Australian Bureau of Statistics reported today. But given budget forecasts of 1.5 million new permanent arrivals in the country in the next 5 years, it's curious to see a net 14,580 permanent arrivals in March. That's up from 12,100 in February. So let's bring in demographer Mark McCrindle. Mark, many thanks for your time. The issue is here, as everybody, and I keep asking this question, is if we've got so many people coming to the country, where are they all going to live? And is Australia actually ready for such a large swathe of migrants to come to the country?
Well, it is a challenge with those big numbers. I mean, on the good news story, international students are back, 53,000 just in the last month, which is twice what we had same month last year. So students are back, and they are the ones that are filling up the inner city that has exited. You know, we did see the decline in the living in our CBDs since COVID as people relocated to regions and outer suburbs. But the students are bringing back that buzz and that high occupancy rate in the city, which is great. But yes, as you get permanent arrivals, long-term people coming on skilled visas, they're going to want to set up homes. They're going to add to the demand for housing and drive up both the rental and the affordability challenges in buying homes.
Well, the government's just done its review into our migration policies and says the previous system was broken. It wants a new system to bring the right people in, equipped with the right skills for Australia. But just give me some sense of when you have a large influx of people into a country, as is expected over these next few years, what is the impact on the community when that takes place?
Well, it does create that extra domestic demand. It creates an economic boom. Australia has done well through migration because of the extra tailwinds that provides to the economy. So all of that's fantastic. But from an individual perspective, when people are already finding wait lists at public hospitals, challenging to get into the local schools, bottlenecks in travel and transport, and of course, the house costs and rental price rises, that's where the pain hits. Australians are big supporters of cultural diversity and benefit from the richness of that. And most Australians, in fact, more than half of Australians from the census, either themselves were born overseas or have at least one parent born overseas. So we're a migrant miracle story here in Australia, but it does come at a pain point if we can't manage the infrastructure and the housing supply at a time that we've bounced back more quickly than people had expected and the growth is back on again.
So, Mark, well, there's one other aspect of this, and that is Sydney and Melbourne historically are much slower to develop the housing to cope with new migration, whereas southeast Queensland in particular has always been, in many ways, a bit of a beacon in regards to being able to be quick to be able to produce that housing and really has seen big spurts in its population in history. So does it seem as though that is the natural place where a lot of the new population that arrives in Australia is likely to land? Adelaide being another place where clearly it seems to be open for business and open for the scientists to turn up there as well.
Well, that's right. You know, we need to get the growth, and most of our population growth, 60% of it, is through overseas migration. So we need to get that growth to the areas that are looking for that population increase. That's the regions and the smaller capitals. Now, New South Wales, or particularly Sydney and Melbourne, they are gateways to international arrivals. That is still the case. But if we can start to get a bit of a change where the overseas world sees Brisbane and southeast Queensland as a global destination, that might grow. Now, southeast Queensland is the number one destination for the internal migration. That's where locals are moving. Massive growth at the moment into southeast Queensland internally. And you're right, you know, they've got the capacity right up the coast of Queensland to absorb more growth, as well as the regional parts of Australia, Adelaide, as you said, and Perth as well. Even the top end in Darwin is looking for some of that growth. So we do need to get the balance right, and we can't just have Sydney and Melbourne soaking up 80% of overseas arrivals, which has been the historical case.
And just one thing, with an ageing population and so therefore workers leaving the workforce increasingly over these next few years, the need for this new migration to create the taxes, to create the productivity, that's important as those older workers leave the workforce.
Well, that's right. The key two sources of migrants coming is to boost the economy in terms of overseas students coming here. That's a big earner. And of course, the tourists. But secondly, to be a boost to the workforce, as you say, in a time of aging when we haven't been able to plug some of those shortfalls. So there's a big need for it. It's needed for the economy. That's why it's being dialed up. But we do need to get the supply side right in terms of making sure that the lifestyle, the quality of life for locals is not upended by the economic booms that come from big migration.